200 years ago, the North American continent west of the Mississippi River was virtually unknown. Trappers had penetrated parts of it, but the land and the people to the northwest were a mystery. At this same time, President Thomas Jefferson was negotiating with Napoleon Bonaparte, Emperor of France, to buy the land that became known as the Louisiana Purchase. Jefferson wanted to know more about the vast new holdings of the United States that lay beside the Missouri River, and if there might be a way to traverse the Rocky Mountains to the Pacific coast. There were reports that the distance from the headwaters of the Missouri to the headwaters of the westward flowing rivers was so short that men could drag a canoe from one to the other. There was also a report that a tribe of Indians in the region was blue-eyed and spoke Welsch. Both stories prove false. In 1803, Jefferson convinced Congress to fund an expedition, a voyage of discovery that would set out from St. Louis, a town of 5,000 people, and travel up the Missouri River to its beginning and then down the west side of the Continental Divide to the Pacific Ocean. He picked two men he could trust to lead the expedition, Meriwether Lewis and William Clark. Both were young Army officers dedicated to President Jefferson. Meriwether Lewis was assigned to the mission by the President, and on July 4, 1803, he set out from Washington to St. Louis to meet Clark and begin preparing for the trip that would leave the following May. We know that Lewis and Clark made the voyage of discovery and return in September of 1806 as heroes of one of the most heralded adventures in American history. Have you ever wanted to hear a firsthand accounting of the trip? Suspend reality for a few moments as I speak with Meriwether Lewis through the historical reenactor Clay Jenkinson. Captain Lewis, you've just returned from a two-year trip from St. Louis to the Pacific Ocean and back again. How does it feel to be home?
Well, I'm delighted to have returned safely. You know, we took more than 45 people with us when we left St. Louis on May 14, 1804, and I am very happy to report that only one of that group died. His name was Charles Floyd, and he died early on in the expedition on August 20th, 1804. He died of what we called bilious colic. We buried him on a bluff overlooking the Missouri River. But beyond that, I was able to bring back my entire company safe and sound.
It's truly amazing that a trip of this kind could return with almost all of its men. Let's start at the beginning. How difficult was it to go up the Missouri River?
Well, very difficult indeed. First of all, the river is a very hard river to navigate. There are sandbars. There are what are called sawyers, which are logs, trunks of trees that are half buried in the bottom of the river, and they saw up and down as the current goes by. The banks of the river are highly unstable, and they fall in with sometimes terrific regularity. It's almost impossible to find a channel that one can really move upward, and then the current is so swift that it's very difficult to push against the mightiness of the river. We used tow ropes, we had pushing oars, and we also sometimes rowed our boats. And if the winds happened to be just right, occasionally we could sail up the river. But it was an age in which all of that labor really was transferred from the muscles in the backs of my men into motive force. And I have to say, although the men never complained and never grumbled, they worked harder than I have ever seen any human beings work.
To take a keelboat against the current had to be difficult. You also had a lot of supplies, so you were counting on a long journey.
You have to understand that when we left St. Louis, we had to carry everything with us that we could possibly require for 3 years without the slightest hope of resupply. That is, we had to carry enough clothing, enough medicine, Indian trade gifts, blankets for the men, foodstuffs of a durable nature, all of our medicine, absolutely everything, including guns and ammunition, had to be supplied for a three-year journey because, I need hardly tell you, there wasn't a single fort, trading post, or store between St. Louis and the Pacific Ocean.
You made your distance to the west and then turning northward with the river getting smaller and less tributaries coming into it. How far did you make it before you had to stop for the first winter?
The first year of travel was between the mouth of the Missouri at Camp Wood or St. Charles to the Great Bend of the Missouri far up in the Dakotas. And this was a distance of about 1,600 miles. It took us from May 14, 1804 until October 26, 1804 to traverse that distance. And then we stopped only because ice was beginning to flow in the river, and we realized that the plains winter was such that we couldn't make any significant further forward progress. So that part of the journey, having ended in late October 1804, we decided to build an encampment among some Indians called the Mandan and Hidatsa, who were Earth Lodge peoples clustered around the mouth of the Knife River on the upper Missouri. And in fact, this was an interesting discovery. There were about 4,500 of them. So we spent the winter in an urban environment, a little compound that we built out of cottonwood logs and called Fort Mandan.
Did you encounter any Plains Indians on your way north?
Yes, a number of them. Otoes and Missouris were our first encounter. Then we had some time with Yanktonai Sioux. Then a very difficult, nearly fatal encounter with the Teton Sioux Indians near Your Pier, South Dakota. And then finally, after that harrowing encounter with the Teton, we had much more harmonious encounters with the Arikara, and then with the Mandan and Hidatsa. So a fair amount of Indian encounter in the first year of travel.
Were these Indians that were the most difficult armed equally to you?
No, they weren't, but they outnumbered us, of course, by about 10 to 1. The Teton Sioux had some muskets. They had gotten them from Minnesota trading posts and through a very extensive intertribal trading network that extended all the way to the Hudson's Bay and to the southwest at Santa Fe and overland to the Wisconsin area. But they didn't have many such guns and very little ammunition. But what they had were numbers and determination. You see, the Teton Sioux were in an expansion phase of their own culture, and they felt that they owned the Missouri, and they had roughed up a number of previous trading vessels and made it quite clear to us between the 26th and the 28th of September 1804 that we could either turn back or leave a substantial portion of our goods with them. But we could not go upriver untaxed, and they fully intended to enforce their sense of ownership on the upper Missouri. And so that's what produced the crisis. They could have wiped us out if they had run at us with overwhelming numbers, but we had a great deal of firepower on our side.
Did you, while at the winter camp, add any members to your expedition to assist you?
A Frenchman who had spent time amongst the Cheyenne Indians, a man named Baptiste Lepage. And then there was a trader, a kind of resident trader named Toussaint Charbonneau. And Charbonneau spoke the Hidatsa language, and he made his services available to us immediately upon our arrival. We did not have much respect for him, but we needed his linguistic capacities. And on November 11th, 1804, he brought down two Snake Indian wives of his, and one of them proved to be the famous Sacagawea. And we hired them as a couple to go with us all the way to the Shoshone people, and she was Shoshone by birth, and the expectation was that when we got to the Shoshone, she would help us to negotiate for a horse herd, a pack string of horses that would take our luggage over the Shining Mountains, over the Rockies. And so she and her husband came with us, and then to our considerable surprise and some chagrin, she gave birth on February 11th, 1805, to her first child, Jean-Baptiste Charbonneau, and that infant, 55 days old at the time of our departure from Fort Mandan, eventually traveled with us all the way to the Pacific Ocean and back again. So four new members hired in Dakota.
Captain Lewis, let's continue through the spring of 1805. You set out to find the headwaters of the Missouri and to see if you could take your canoes over to the streams on the west side of the Rocky Mountains to begin the trip to the Pacific Ocean. Did you think it would be that simple?
No, by the time we left the Fort Mandan area, we had realized that the Bitterroot Mountains, the Shining Mountains, were probably not capable of a canoe portage. We sent the keelboat back downriver in April of 1805. It was simply too bulky to go on. We made six cottonwood dugout canoes from trees that we hacked down at the Great Bend of the Missouri. And with that little flotilla of our two original pirogues and six dugouts, we made our way west. We knew that when we got to the source of the Missouri, we would have to abandon all of those boats, cross the Rocky Mountains with a pack herd, and then on the other side, we would have to make more vessels in order to go down the waters of the Columbia to the Pacific. So we had sort of already disabused ourselves of Mr. Jefferson's romantic notion that the portage between the navigable waters of the Missouri and navigable waters of the Columbia would be a half a day. We sensed long before we got there that this was a species of wishful thinking on the part of the president.
It did show that there was very little known about the area. Didn't you make a long trip around an area that you could have cut across?
Well, yes, but I mean, first of all, let me say that it was unknown territory. When we left Fort Mandan on April 7, 1805, I said in my journal, "We are now about to penetrate a country at least 2,000 miles in width upon which the foot of civilized man has never trodden." And I meant that very seriously. We were entering true unknown territory, terra incognita, and every time we came around a bend in the river, we were seeing a prospect that had never in the course of human history been seen by scientific eyes, by somebody with an alphabet, by somebody with a sustained culture and cultural artifacts. So we felt very proud of all of this, but we were also somewhat apprehensive, and we knew that there were going to be difficulties, and when we finally got to the source of the Missouri, we were delighted and proud, and we had a sense of triumph, but we also were aware that we had gone by a very inefficient route. And over the winter, William Clark and I looked at our maps and realized that if we had cut directly across from the Great Falls, we could have saved literally hundreds of miles. But let me remind you that the President of the United States, Mr. Jefferson, did not authorize us to find a land route. He wanted us to find the source of the Missouri River, which in fact we did on August 12, 1805.
All along the way, you and Captain Clark mapped the area, and you kept records of the flora and fauna. How did you keep your focus when you were struggling to stay alive?
Well, we didn't struggle much. I mean, there were two periods where we had real difficulties, and they were both in the Bitterroot Mountains. On the way out in 1805, we nearly starved to death because those mountains were much more rugged and higher and more extensive and void of game than we could have anticipated. And then on the way back, the same thing. Those were the two ordeal periods of the expedition. Beyond that, for most of the time that we were on our 28-month journey, we were pretty much in control of our destiny, and there wasn't too much to be afraid of. I spent many, many days on shore alone, looking for plant samples, trying to shoot and preserve previously unknown animals, examining birds and taking down bird calls, attempting to describe adequately the lay of the landscape in the upper Missouri country. And I was able to keep my focus pretty well. I should say, however, that it probably could not have occurred, all of the science, if it hadn't been for William Clark. While I was doing the science of the expedition, Clark was in every important way handling the day-to-day business of getting our boats upriver, and that, I think, was extremely valuable because I could not have done both.
You said you had a very troubling period. Can you tell me what it meant to you when you were able to locate the Shoshone people?
Well, the Shoshone came on the eastern side of the Shining Mountains. They were the last Indians we met before we crossed the Continental Divide. And I'll tell you, I was thrilled for many reasons. First of all, that meant that I was at the source of the what I called the mighty and heretofore deemed endless Missouri River. And I will never forget the moment on August 12, 1805, when I was actually able to stand with one foot on either side of that river. You know, at St. Louis, the river is more than a mile wide. And suddenly, I was at the absolute fountain of one of the world's great rivers. And it was there, in extreme southwestern Montana, that I met the Shoshone. And the Shoshone were very interesting because they had never seen a white man before, and they were also, in a way, refugee Indians who had been driven up into the mountains by their gun-toting plains neighbors, the Blackfeet and the Atsina. I had to struggle with all of my might to make a successful first encounter with this people. Once we did, you know, we brought in Sacagawea. She was Shoshone, as I said, from birth, and she, of course, knew the Shoshone language. And the most amazing thing happened when she sat in the council tent and looked across at the chief of the tribe and began to do her work as a translator. She discovered that that chief was her own brother, Kamiowate. They had been separated for at least 5 years. She'd been kidnapped, captured by the Hidatsa Indians, and presumed dead, I'm sure. Suddenly, she's back with this group of bearded strangers, and she meets her brother, and they had an extraordinarily emotional reunion. even I was moved by it, but I can't help remembering that I thought at the time, we're probably now going to get the horses that we need to cross the Bitterroot Mountains.
So very fortuitous that this great coincidence happened, but it seemed to only set you up to extend yourselves beyond your capabilities.
Well, not beyond our capabilities, because we did get through the Bitterroots, and we did survive without the loss of a single life. And although we were hungry and dispirited and bewildered and at a very low ebb in our morale, we had horses, and if in extremity we would have had to kill them to eat. We killed several ponies in order to eat. In fact, we named a creek Kilt Colt Creek in honor of the colt that we had to kill in order to survive. But we were never in any danger of death. But we were, and I worried a lot about this, we were in danger of the collapse of the expedition. I felt on a number of occasions over our journey, and particularly there, that the morale had reached a point of near collapse, and if there were any more setbacks, that the expedition might be defeated, and we might have to turn back and ignominiously scramble back to St. Louis.
Once you reached the far side, you were so weak. Did you find aid from any other Indian tribe?
Yes, the Nez Perce. I don't say they saved our lives, but they certainly greatly improved them. We sort of tumbled into a Nez Perce camp. William Clark went on ahead, in fact, with a small reconnaissance party to try to make contact and get help to the main party. He made contact with the Nez Perce. The Nez Perce could not have been more friendly. In fact, they were amongst our favorite Indians. And they provided us with camas root, which is a bulb that they dig up on the prairies, and with dried salmon. And although these both played havoc with our digestive systems, they did provide us the nutrition that we needed to get back on our feet. And we spent enough time with these ingenious Pierce Nose Indians to recover our spirits. And once we had, thanks to them, we built dugout canoes again in their country, and then began to go down rivers that were later known as the Clearwater, the Snake, and finally the Columbia itself.
From historical records, Sacagawea kept you going, didn't she?
Probably her most important role was a symbolic one. The fact that she was traveling with us with a child was a sign to the Indians of the West that whatever else we were doing, we were not up to no good. And on two occasions, Clark, in his diary, reports that her very presence as an Indian woman traveling with this group of white males disarmed the potential hostilities amongst Indian people.
You are now to the point that you found the first of the westward flowing rivers. Did you, as you continued on, begin to return to civilization?
Well, not really. You know, it was a terrible ironic surprise. You know, the Missouri River is navigable almost to its source. Aside from the Great Falls of the river, which I discovered on June 13, 1805, the river has very few impediments. And I said in my journals, I don't know of any single river on earth that is navigable so deep into the heart of the wilderness, so close to its source in the mountains. And I said on the same occasion, if the river on the other side, the Rio Oregon or the Rio Columbia, is anything like this gentle, it has great promise for the future of our search for a Northwest Passage. But, of course, the rivers on the western slope of the Rockies are not nearly so friendly. The first river that we discovered was one that we called the River of No Return. And it was so violent that we didn't feel that we could navigate it. So we went overland through the Bitterroots until we reached the Clearwater. And the Clearwater was difficult too, but we managed to survive. We took chances on the downriver journey that we would never have taken if it weren't so late in the traveling season and if we hadn't been so seasoned as explorers. So we were really taking some pretty significant risks. Fortunately, everything came out all right. And then finally, as we got down the true Columbia, well, we entered the Columbia from the Snake on October 16th, 1805. And during the month that we spent on the true Columbia, we began to see signs of civilization. Not white people, but Indians who clearly had contact with white people. For example, we saw a woman with a tattoo, Jay Bowman, on her arm. And we saw several Indians wearing pieces of white clothing. I hate to say this, but the first English that we heard from Fort Mandan all the way to the Pacific Ocean was a Lower Columbia Indian who said, "Son of a pitch." So we were a little surprised and disappointed to see that the effects of white civilization on the Lower Columbia Indians was not altogether as Mr. Jefferson might have wanted.
We'll continue our interview with Meriwether Lewis reenactor Clay Jenkinson on CD or cassette too.